discuss with the patent about the process in chapter 2, our second unit. So today I would like to describe more details about the past two times the teaching and communication. Very easy content overall introduction. Today I want to we're trying to go into the more detail, more detailed content about the semiconductor processing. So for semiconductor processing, we divide it into several parts. Clean room, paper preparation, and the semiconductor process. So we introduce clean room at first. Tell you what the presentation about the silicon wafer. And finally, we will say about the semiconductor process. So don't forget about our three steps: sinking growth, photolithography, and etching. So we describe each part one by one. Let's look at the clean room. Okay, clean room. When we talk about clean room, our idea is due to we are afraid of particle contamination. Actually, we are afraid of the particle contamination. Why? Because our semiconductor device, for example, our IC, our transistor is getting smaller and smaller due to the law of what? Moore's law. Moore is the co-founder of Intel, pretty big company, right? Co-founder of Intel, he didn't ever predict the trend, the semiconductor transistor in 1970. Inside 1970, he predicted this stuff is getting smaller and smaller, and he suspect maybe 2 years. 2 years, the transistor density can be doubled. But finally, in 1980, he tried to modify his model. He said, not 2 years, it's 1.5 years, 18 months. He said, only 18 months, doubled. 1 centimeter square area can be this. This year is 1 million, right? And 18 months later, 2 million put together in the same area. Because the technology, right? The technology go forward, make it more advanced. So in the Moore's law, a transistor density double per 18 months. So the growth rate is pretty high compared to our mechanical industry, right? You know, in our mechanical industry, if some product can have the annual growth rate above 5% or 6%, it's pretty good. But for semiconductor, it's not just about 6 or 5%. It's about 70%, right? About 70%. But if 1.5 year double, you mean the annual growth rate. Annual growth rate every year is about 70%. So it's very, very huge growth rate. So it's the most low. Even to now, a lot of people are still regard the most low as the golden rule, the first law in the semiconductor fabrication. So the reason why, kind of from the language of the transistor, from 3 micrometer right now down to approximately about 7 nanometer. Nanometer is only 1/1000 of a micrometer, 10 to minus 9, right? So it's very, very small dimension. But gradually, maybe you have some ideas to talk about the Moore's law of the VR force. It's getting increased the dimension of the transistor, but finally, you will reach its upper limit. What's the upper limit? Atom size. Atom size is the upper limit. You cannot shrink our dimension smaller than atom. So more snow than you will reach the center. Not only for transistor, we not only miniaturize transistor, we can miniaturize sensor and actuator much together. So our functionality will be better, right? Even on the same chip. In the past, not only the transistor total number is large, but also the function when not getting large. We can not only do the signal processing only, we can do sensing, we can do actuating from the environment to the environment. Of course, about all the stuff about the Moore's law depends on what we call about the critical dimension. The critical dimension can describe how good is our semiconductor process technology right now. For example, I always say TSMC, right, in Taiwan, right now they have a technology about 7 nanometer, right? 7 nanometer, why you say 7 nanometer? It's critical dimension. Critical dimension. What is the critical dimension? In the line width. There's a wire, metal wire. The wire, the line width is only 7 nanometer wide. Or the line spacing. This line, another line, there's a spacing, right? Separates two lines. Now maybe you need one critical dimension or two critical dimensions. Maybe another hole, want to penetrate, right? Maybe want to dig a hole into our wafer. What the size of this hole? What the diameter of this hole? Or maybe you need one critical dimension or two critical dimensions. So critical dimension is the minimum resolution about the micromachining. So all this stuff, whatever the most low critical dimension, in patient, the idea, the miniaturization, we are concerned that our semiconductor device is too tiny. It's so tiny that they are very fragile particle. Because particle right now larger than the dimension of the transistor. So if any particle in our daily life, right? For example, in this classroom, in this class, it's not clean room, it's a classroom. Right, only classroom. Classroom what? In cubic centimeter, in cube, 1 feet cube area, maybe 1 million particles inside. And each particle may be larger than 1 micrometer. So much larger than our semiconductor device. So if you put your fabrication process line in this dirty environment, no hope to successfully make your transistor. Or make your semiconductor device. Because open circuit or short circuit will happen very quickly. So you have no hope to finish a perfect semiconductor device. So we must deal with this particle contamination. So a clean room is necessary. Right? You must do the clean process in the clean room. No particle contamination. No particle contamination. And even more, right? So I will see, for example, so you will prevent, why to prevent the electrical short circuit or open circuit? Why the short circuit or open circuit? For example, in our chip, if there are two wires, right, making our device very, very narrow, two wires, and there's a particle going down, between these two wires. Okay. Yeah, if the particle is conductive, this line shows up here. Shows up here, right? In the first case, the other shows up. And how about the open circuit? Still, we have the particle, right? Hold it down at this place. And you want to deposit these two lines together, metal line put together. But there is an obstacle particle over here. We have no idea. We code it. So the line they can will go up the bump from the particle and pass through, right? But after that, we do the cleaning, the particle leak. How about these two parallel lines? There is a gap, right? So is an open circuit. It's an open circuit. So whatever short circuit or open circuit, both cases are bad to our successful fabrication. So we need to avoid them. So no way to do but try to filter all the particles from our clean room. So you need to define the standard of your clean room. We use the class to identify the quality, good quality of our clean room. So for example, we say, oh, this clean room is class 10. What is a class 10? Class 10 means there is less than 10 particles. Less than 10 particles, which diameter is smaller than 25 micron in the cubic feet space. In this space, clean room class 10 is only 10 particles. Only 10 particles. The class 10 is good, actually. Yeah. Depends on what your critical dimension has. Depends on your critical dimension. Your critical dimension is very, very small. Maybe you don't have to do that. So this is the, we show here a standard. So in the class 1, for example, class 1 means that in class 10 is 10 particles. How about class 1? Only one particle. So which one is better? Class 1 or class 10? Class 1 is better. So the number larger, you can say, oh, it's good, no, it's very bad. So for example, in our environment, maybe class 1 million. Right? Class 1 million. Very, very bad. Impossible to do the semiconductor process. So you can see, class 1, and our particle size is 0.15 micron, only one particle. Right? But sometimes you will see 0.5 micron particle is too big. To us, I care about the 0.1 particle. Maybe 0.1 particle. If any particle has the diameter size larger than 0.1 micron, maybe it's a killer. It's a killer. So I change the standard from 0.5 to 0.1. To 0.1, what's the total amount of the particle right now? Equivalent to 35 particles. Even there are 35 microsystems, with 35 particles with the particle size of 0.1 micron, we call it a class 1. So actually, you can keep increasing. You can keep. So in principle, there's a better classroom than 0.1 now. We got now, if the number getting less, the quality better. So it's a table for your reference like this. And how can we make the clean room very perfect? We need the HEPA, high efficient particulate air. HEPA means that there is a filter. Actually, it's a filter. The material may be made by teflon or made by some glass fiber. They use very fine mesh, a filter. We'll put on our ceiling of our clean rooms. Like this figure. If it is a clean room, the people working inside, right? So HEPA is on the ceiling. And when the air from the top to down, top down, all the laminar flow in the air, is from top to down. We have no other direction. If you have other direction, we will generate some circulation flow. It's bad for your particle to stay over there. So we need to provide a downwash flow. Downwash flow can shorten the duration time the particle stay on our clean room. So we call it the laminar flow. But this laminar flow is vertical direction. And so this is a clean air. Pass through the HEPA, there is a clean air. But after contact with the particle, contact with our person or machine, machine will operate. Sometimes it will operate, sometimes it has rotation, moving parts, like pump, There's a lot of pumping, creating some motion, shaking, vibration. We are shaking out some particles. Then we have some oil. Oil droplet and comes out. So you generate extra particles. So when you put it down to the ground, right now, in this area, there's a lot of particles out on the ground. So we need to recycle. So a lot of hole on the bottom, a lot of hole on the bottom will recycle. I recycle the recycle piping, connect back to the heat pump. So when we recycle back, because the air is so precious, so we don't use the open system, we use a closed system. Only have some part, we call it a bypass. Maybe sometimes we need some ideas. You mean that we not use absolutely the same air circulating in this clean room, but sometimes we need some bypass. There's a bypass. Sometimes we will feed some fresh air into it. And sometimes there's a piping out. So maybe some in, some out. Right? But basically, most of the air we are separate. We can save a lot of energy and fresh air. So he has some partial circulation, some maybe 80% air circulating, and some fresh air into some dirty gas out. So you maintain this kind of clean room. Like this man. So HEPA is a consuming material. So for all the clean room used every day, not every day, maybe every 3 months you should press with a new HEPA. And HEPA is very expensive. It's not only a sponge. For us, only sponge is quite good for our automobile, right? But for clean room, you know, you can understand the particle. Even the particle is a fine micron, even less than the term, we call it the PM2.5 air pollution, right? PM2.5 right now, a lot of pollution go around less, right? PM2.5 is a particle size about 2.5 micron, larger than the particle we care about. We care about 0.5 or even smaller. So the ordinary filter is not good for us. We need a very high efficiency filter. It's called the HEPA. The HEPA is very expensive. So every season we should change. Even for my clean room. My clean room is very easy, but I need to repress the HEPA every 6 months or even my 9 months I should repress. Each time I repress, it costs me about one less. It's about my 1 month salary about. So very expensive. But you can know that you need to maintain this air during the first aspect I mentioned here. And then you have also very many rules and regulations about the clean room. You can see the temperature always 20 degrees C inside. And the relative humidity is 40% inside. Relative humidity of 40% is very hard to maintain in Taiwan. Because in Taiwan, we often have the relative cubic larger than 70% all year, or even higher. Taiwan climate is very little bit near to India, very humid. We don't like the case in the United States. The United States is a continent, right? It's a big land. Right? So in big land, in the inner side, the humidity is very, very low. 40% is very often found. So if we construct an IC factory in the United States, in a big land area, they don't even care about the relative. The relative humidity is very, very slow, but in Taiwan, very high. So our air conditioner, our AC, is not open AC. Even AC for the clean room is not open AC. You need to get rid of the moisture, water moisture. Feeding out. So all the gas feeding into the clean room, you should go through the process we called a preheating. Preheating pump. So it means that if there is a bypass air into right, so it actually is a heating. We need to do the preheating. Otherwise, we cannot deal with the problem of the humidity. The ordinary AC only can control the humidity as low as 55, right, the maximum. 55% is their maximum capacity. Lower than that, impossible. So you need a heater to get rid of the water moisture. So even for this aspect, it's not so easy. Clean room for us is very small. But for TSMC, big IC company, IC factory, how big? It's a football field. All the areas are made low. So you can see the power, the required power for IC factory is amazing. They even more need their independent power plant to provide their necessary electricity, other than no function. They are very hard to about the electrical shutdown. Yeah. If the electrical shutdown happened one time, wow, amazing. All their wafers gone. All their fabricated wafers gone. Because you know, for our IC fabrication, they need a continuous running about the wafer for 1 month. But during this 1 month, electrical shutdown is absolutely not allowed. If you electrical shut down, it means that all the process stop suddenly. So all the process in high temperature process stop. Stop means what? Finish. What is finish? No use. No use. You should start it from zero. So in the factory, there are 40,000 pieces to run for wafer running, and then the electrical shutdown costs you $7 billion loss. So electrical shutdown is not a problem. So for TSMC in Taiwan, right now they have their own wafer, their own power plant. They have all power plant to keep, to provide the necessary power continuously, reliably. And then for we show we have to go there, right? They cannot go from part to part. Another issue is electrostatic discharge, ESD. Electrostatic discharge, what is the electrostatic discharge? This property is coupled with the low humidity. Maybe not in the winter day, it's very cold, right? Very cold, very dry. If we open your home, or open your door, what happens? Spark, right? And then enter some electrostatic discharge, right? Maybe you shake hands with other people. There's some sparking, right? You open the door to your automobile, right? This is very important. Electrostatic discharge. This kind of sparking or discharge release is nothing to do about us. No problem, just a surprise. Only a surprise, right? But for wafer, oh my god, it's something like a sound port. It has a boom, sound port. So they destroy everything on the wafer. One spark on the silicon wafer may be cause hundreds of device fail, burn off. So it's not allowed. It's not allowed. It means that all the electrical charge. But the reason why we have this kind of phenomena, because our body may be some insulator where ink will accumulate charge on our body, right? Maybe our shoes. So electrical isolated. So when we do the walking, so there is some friction to accumulate charge on our bodies. So we have some difference about electrical potential. I mean the voltage difference. So we get closing, right? Current, huge, right? Goes through. So the only way you can do about avoiding this kind of phenomena is what? We try to make everything in a clean room. Exactly grounded. Grounded. So how it means that trying to make the environment neutral, electrical neutral, no extra charge, no extra charge. So inside the clean room, you can see some bars. We call it a chloride this charger. Even that, something like many bars of the city. It will sense the environment. If the environment has an extra charge, it will release properly positive ion or negative ion to the batteries. So keep the overall neutral state of the environment to avoid any kinds of electrical discharge. Yes. So ESD is also very important. Air shell is for a person want to enter into the clean room, you have some particle. Even you are dressed with a clean suit, clean room suit. But you have some particle outside, so you should use the air shell to get rid of the particle. And all men dressed in the clean suit. Even the water we use inside is called the DI water, the ionized water, it's a pure water, without any kinds of ions, any kinds of sodium, chloride, impurity, particle, virus, bacteria, nothing left inside. So it's very, very pure DI water. You use the DI water to do the process of cleaning. And DI water, I can tell you, DI water is the most powerful cleaner in the world. Cleaner. When I was a child, my mother ever told me, ever asked me when the rainy day. She said, I'll go outside when the rainy day to collect some water, the drink water. You want to do some cleaning. Yeah. You know, in the early age, you know, the rain water is very clean. Almost like the DI water, very, very clean. Even it's a particle, but nothing to hear the inside. But it's like the DI water. So my mother used the DI water to clean everything, detecting. You don't need to use the soap, but you can get rid of it. You can do the cleaning very effectively. Even you go to glass store, right? Glass store, spectacle store, you will ask the to clean the spectacle for you, right? That they use the ultrasonic shaking. And what the liquid inside? The liquid inside the ultrasonic shaking is DI water. Pure water. The pure water is the most wonderful cleaner. Not organic solution. Organic solution can deal with some grease or oil. But believe me, some dirty thing over there, you use the DI water, always brush. After one period of time, clean. So water is the best cleaner in the world. So we use the DI water very much in the clean room. But DI water, you want to generate DI water, you need a special machine to generate DI water. So it's not easy. A lot of things you should provide. You need a reverse osmotic membrane. You need the UV. Now UV can kill the bacteria and the virus. And then you need different kinds of ion exchanging resin. So a lot of things you need to support the generating of the DI water. So everything ready that your clean room can be used. So here I show you one video taking our clean room. So in the trailer, look at my laptop. The student is going to enter into the clean room. Before enter into, okay, log in. Before we doing any works in the clean room, we should log in or register. So if any problem about the machine, if any problem about the machine, something wrong, we can can find for the first time and try to restore, fix it and restore. So logging is very important. Register, signing is very important. And try to address the clean suit. So yeah, cover your hair, mask, and then dress in the clean suit. There is a hat. Compared to TSMC, our clean suit is simpler. If you want to go to working in the TSMC, the big company, you spend about 10 minutes to fully dress. You like the astronaut, spaceman. Yeah. So of course, the clean suit should be AC. You know AC, nobody can stay. Wow, very, very hard. And then, not finished. Not yet finished. We just have a hand and back and you got your foot. So you have the special shoe. Of course, all the clothing and shoe, hat, should be clean. Very often. So, company, they have a special store can handle the clean suit. The clean suit is not disposable. Not only used for one time, it can be used many, many times. So you use a special cleaner. Use special cleaner to clean your suit. And now, okay, glue is necessary. Okay, so everything fine. Even though we have spectacles, you can put your spectacles to protect your eyes. There are some chemicals maybe harmful to your eyes, so have a glass is better. Okay, the air shaft. You go into it, the air shaft, a lot of jet flow will try to remove the particle from the sky. Okay, they go inside. Go inside the room. Bring the first part of the entering into the clean room. You must have some preparation about the people. In some cases, not only for the, no, there's an air shaft, right? With a door. You go into the door, there's a space for you to do the air shaft, right? Not only for that, for people. There's an extra pass-through window. We call it a pass window, pass glass. What is it? If you want to take something into the clean room, if you put something with you into the air shaft, you will generate some blocking, no blocking, so the particle cannot exactly remove during the air shower process. So it's better for you to tap the your box in this window, put inside, so people go through along, and then inside the clean room, the goods or box, they will do the air shower by itself. So from the inner window, you can pick up. So separate, this pass is for men, this pass is for parts or other extra objects. But even for this kind of door, also should obey. Otherwise, the particle inside your clean room is getting larger and larger. Finally, your clean room will become very dirty, very dirty. To dirty, your production year or successful rate will increase. Okay, so the first part of the clean room, finish. And then we talked about the wafer fabrication. We talked about now the silicon base. We have silicon base, the micro machine, silicon base, the semiconductor process. So, how to have your silicon wafer is important. But right now, we can buy silicon wafer very easily.
back to 30 years ago, any student want to do the research about the semiconductor device, or very hard, it's very hard. This student should try to grow the crystal by himself or herself. So maybe his first year is trying to learn how to do the crystallization, how to pour the crystal, and use this crystal, single crystal, to do this process. So in the past, it's not easy. But right now, you can buy wafer very convenient at the chip. So we just introduced a little bit about how company can generate wafer. But we don't need to do it. We just buy it. Order and buy. Order and buy. So very easy. But you don't ask know where to come from. We use the Zygotsky method. The Zygotsky method to do the wafer crystal pulling. You look at the wafer, it's only a piece of, right? Like a wafer biscuit, right? Or a tea time, right? Right? Very thin bread, biscuit. Very thin. But originally, he hit it with an ingot. You mean that there's a high temperature melt. The high temperature furnace, high temperature melt. And pure silicon melt inside. Silicon, purified. And melt with a temperature about 1450 degrees C, larger than their melting point of the silicon. So very high temperature furnace. And then we put a small bar, we call it a C. Crystal C is a good reference for you. Good reference for you to grow the bigger crystal bar from this small C. It's something like a farmer, right? Farmer. Very similar to the farmer. Farmer every year enter the harvest the crops. You will conserve, right? You will conserve some part of the seed for the next year to use, right? To the seed. So similar for crystal fabrication, for paper, silicon paper fabrication. Every time we make a single crystal silicon, we will reserve some part of the single crystal and dicing it with the seed. And for the next time, use it. Create a seed. Like a seed. The seed can generate into a very big. So it grows. Especially if the seed just only a very small bar. And then it gradually grows to a very big. Called the ingot. Ingot is tree-like. Crystal, single crystal block. Very big. So if you have your 12-inch silicon wafer, the total diameter of your ingot is larger than 13-inch bigger. It's bigger than the silicon wafer. And after the, so you can pour the single crystal greater. The speed is very slow. The total processing time may be up to 4 days, 1 day. Right, see, and finally, pour into a very good maybe a 1 day process, 1 day process. So it's a pulling with the wafer, ingot pulling. So in the first method, we call it the Zygotsky method. So there may be more than 90% of the wafer generated by this method. And another method you can use is what called the floating door method. Personal method is a little bit different. Method is a recrystallization method. What is it? It means that we can start it from the ingot, but with the shape or with the configuration not crystallized. For example, we can do some molding, right? We use a mold. So you melt and go into. So after solidify, you have an ingot, but non-crystal. It's not crystalline. You need polycrystal. Or even amorphous. Polycrystal or amorphous. Christmas Day, and then we started from the sea. Then we locally mail the part of this gift on Christmas Day. So we local mail, so the alignment with the sea. So it becomes a crystal. And then we move your local heating core gradually. Goes through all the legs of the income. And finally, you will come to the single crystal. We call it a floating dog. Floating dog method. Very natural here. A floating dog. If you wonder what the real process is, you can do it. The floating dog method is another method for you to approach. And compared to that classic, sometimes the floating dog method can produce more pure, more less impurity. Very, very less the impurity to stay inside. I can control the impurity of the wafer. So whenever you want to buy a wafer, the company will ask you, you want the CD wafer or FD wafer? Or you cannot do it. You will want the very high impurity. You select FD. FD is more expensive. CD is very cheap. For 4-inch wafer like this, single wafer 4-inch, only $500 or $1,000. $1,000 for 1-inch. But if for 14 dollars, double price. Double price. More expensive. But impurity, good. Also, the 14 dollars. Okay, so you have the income of all, like a tree, right? Like a tree trunk. Then we send to the machine, we do the slicing. So we put in the machine like the legs. So that's the rotate, right? The trimming out the outer ring. So we come to a cylinder, and then do the slicing. Do the slicing. One piece by one piece, one piece by one piece. Do the slicing. You know, even the slicing is not easy. It's not easy because you know what the thickness of the wafer. For our 4-inch wafer, the thickness is about 500 micron, 0.5, 0.5 millimeter, 500 micrometer, 4-inch. How about 12-inch? 12-inch, only 800 micrometer, 0.8. So not very thick. Even thinner, you know, compared to the dimension. You know, 4-inch, 12-inch, you know, 3 times, right? Like 3 times larger. But the thickness increased a little bit. From 500 micron increased to 800 micron. So even the slicing, the reason why we want to make the thickness so thin is because you can generate more wafer for 1 gigabit. We try to think back our wafer as thin as possible. Correct? Yeah, because if you can generate 200 pieces, right? If you can generate one block, can give you 200 wafer, just do it. If you have to think only 100 pieces, you deserve nothing. Right? So I mean, try to make the slicing very thin. It's not easy. For slicing, in the past, we use a special saw and do the slicing. But right now, people will change to use wire cutting. Use the methodology of wire cutting to do the slicing. You know what the wire cutting is?
review the song with the ice cream. Thank you. learning process. So it's a new way. Go through this structure. Finally, go down. And this put a recycle. Right? So you can see, there's a lot of Dyson saw. These are Dyson saw tricks. And then, so when we push our lever, our in-gas, directly contact with the hundreds line, hundreds of string together, can do the coupling. Right? Do the coupling. Always rotate, always translate, rotate, right? The wire.